I'm going to quickly get on and start the day. Great first keynote speaker, myself and John, quite a long conversation about him a couple of weeks ago, so I'm really delighted to introduce Richard Self this morning. He's going to talk about big data and some of the issues that are coming out of big data, some of the opportunities about big data in the future. But Richard Self, good morning.
Thank you very much. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. I've been sort of interested in this sort of field of big data and analytics and governance for quite a long time. My youngest daughter has been working in the financial market sector for quite a few years and kind of sort of led me into the governance of finance and other things. So it's been very much a focus of my work at the University of Derby for about 5-6 years to think about the consequences of some of this magical technology that we have around us. And Phil was saying that one of the stories that really illustrate very, very powerfully some of the problems of big data analytics, the things we can do and maybe things we shouldn't do. And it goes back about 3 or 4 years. Some of you probably know the story. Who knows of the Target company in the USA? Do you know the story I'm going to tell? A few of you do. How many don't know the story of Target? Right. Connecting data from everywhere to everything. And many of you have your own loyalty schemes. And you can connect what your customers buy to all sorts of other data. We in the UK, in Europe, are slightly constrained compared with the USA. However, the USA don't have the same constraints as the European data protection regime. They collected in Target everything. And the marketeers thought, we've got an interesting opportunity here because we know, they said, that pregnant women change their, have slightly flexible preferences. And we want to lock in on that. So, big data analytics team, can you identify from the patterns of purchasing people or women who are pregnant? The analytics team sort of went off and tried to find out, and then they discovered yes, and they can tell which trimester the girl or woman is in. And they can even pretty much estimate when the delivery date is, from the changing patterns, nest building, and all those other things. And then the marketing team said, wow, that's fantastic. We'll now start sending out little booklets or tokens and so on. Because a lot of people go to Target, or to any supermarket, very much targeted on one or two product ranges. Whereas Target, as a company, had everything. It's a bit like sort of Asda Plus and everything. And so they sent out these booklets or coupons. And yes, they included a few random ones like lawnmowers, which just wasn't quite so obvious the targeting was really creepy. And then suddenly the sky fell in. They'd already told the press about it. And then hackers scored them into the data center to look at this fantastic capability they'd come up with this data, big data analysis. And then, one day, a really angry man turned up in a store, his local store, waving his book of coupons, demanding to see the manager, and said, what are you trying to do? Trying to get my daughter pregnant? He was talking about his 16-year-old daughter who received his book of coupons. The manager was rather taken aback. He'd not heard about this campaign. But would you have told your retail outlets about this sort of campaign? I tried to calm him down and sort of sent him away and said, I'll try and find out. A week later, he phoned up this man and said, not really been able to find out very much, but the man said, I'm sorry, I have to apologise. There were things going on in our house that we didn't know about. The 2-month pregnant 16-year-old hadn't quite got her courage up. Now, these are things that we can do with big data analytics. Should we do them? What's the problem with the analysis in the first place? Or was it in terms of what the marketing team did with that data? Should we really be investigating the pregnancy, the state of pregnancy of our customers even. I leave that as a hanging question, and I'll move on to another area, this main topic here of location services. What I want to do briefly is to cover some governance imperatives that we need to think about if we're going to get value and not cause damage to our organisation. That problem for Target caused an awful lot of reputational damage and was followed up Christmas 2013, or the 14, sorry, when they had that gigantic data breach. That really caused problems for the company. Share price plummeted for a while. Reputational damage is a serious governance issue, folks. Then we'll have a quick look at some of this aspect of mobile phone location services. We think these are accurate because we use them to navigate. I'll show you some data that says, be careful what you do. You need to think about what you do. And then a few thoughts on how we can actually get some value from it. Another little salutary point. We hear a huge amount of hype about big data analytics and the fact it's driving sales up, it's driving margins up, it's driving profit up, all sorts of things. Be careful. I picked up from IBM Insight conference last year in Las Vegas. These projects are around about 30 to 40% successful. So 60% don't gain value, don't deliver the hopeful value. We need to be asking questions. There's quite a bit of research going on, certainly here in my university in Derby, I'm leading with my undergraduate students, to try and understand when is location services accurate and when isn't it. There's some stuff from ThinkNear, which is really scary, and I'll show you the chart in a minute. You need to think about the consequences, the governance consequences of having unreliable location services data when you're trying to do advertising to customers through their mobile phones. Interestingly, big data and analytics projects are having the same level of success or lack of success as been reported by the Standish Group for the last 20 odd years. 35 to 45% of projects are successful on time to budget, delivering the expected benefits. 25-30% fail, and the remainder a challenge late over budget and deliver only 30-40% of the expected or desired and contracted for functionality. One of the problems with big data is there is so much of it. And if you go pattern matching or pattern searching inside large amounts of data, you will find vast numbers of correlations. Some of which are good and helpful and are causally related, and others are very spurious and have no value whatsoever. There's a beautiful graph out on the net which actually compares the number of tons of fresh lemons imported into the USA from Mexico each year and the death rate on the roads in the USA. The actual correlation coefficient, R equals 0.995 or something. Perfect linear correlation, and of course, no obvious or no real connection whatsoever. We have to look at this thing and be sensible and ask ourselves lots of questions. There's another problem within businesses. I'm very, very grateful to a book by Gary Klein for bringing this out. We all want insights. We look at big data as a way of capturing insights, don't we? All that data about our customers, our suppliers, and so on. But are we as an organization really, really interested in doing things with that insight? Or do our management control systems want so much control to make sure we don't make mistakes that we kind of pat it back down and say, thank you for that lovely insight, but I don't want to do anything with it just now. And the final problem with big data, and this comes from an IBM guy, a chap called John Easton. He wrote a paper back in about 2012, and he pointed out that in all of this huge, huge amount of data which is growing at doubling every year and a half, Moore's Law now applies not just to chips, silicon chips, but also to the volumes of data. And he was saying, of all of this huge growth of data, this huge amount of data, including, it turns out, that within our own operational systems, 80% of the data is of uncertain veracity. We cannot trust it. We do not actually know which bits of data are correct and which are wrong. We're not saying 80% is wrong. We're just saying that we can't actually be sure which of our data is correct and which of our data is incorrect. And that's a problem, of course, because how do we believe the insights if we can't even be certain that our data that we're working from is right? This is a graph from a Standish group collected over the last 20 odd years, the first report in 1994. And the blue line and the purple one, that line there, they've changed the basis slightly, are the successful projects. These are the challenge ones late over budget, and the red ones, and going into the orange, are the fail. They never deliver. They start again and again, go round and round and round, and that's it. Nothing happens. You waste a lot of money. There's also a problem we have with all of our projects. And I've seen, because I worked at Rolls-Royce Aerospace for 30 odd years before going to university. And the curious thing about all of these failed projects is we always go into our project knowing absolutely certainly that our project is going to be successful, we're going to be on time, etc. Have we ever beaten the odds before? The odds are 40 to 100 that we're going to be successful. If we have beaten the odds before, then we'd better find out quickly what is it that we're doing so that we actually know what we need to do time after time. That post-implementation audit will tell you, if you're successful, why you have been successful. That then helps you to beat the odds time after time. Standish Group also say that those companies, those projects which are successful on time to budget and so on, is because they have, on average, done the best possible estimates from their program managers, their project managers, their IT experts, and then they have added something like 40 to 60% contingency in terms of money, resources, and time. And then project manage like crazy, and good luck, they're coming on time. We're all familiar with, we're going to give you guys, your project team, a challenging project. Some challenging targets, because it's good for you to have challenging targets, don't we? That project will be challenged. The Standish Group report every year showed that this is the case. If you give your staff a challenging target, the project will be challenged. Have a think. Another aspect that comes into the big data and analytics sort of field is how much do we trust technology? Well, we seem to remember about, gosh, it's 8 years ago, isn't it now? The world collapsed. Subprime mortgage. That was triggered by an unrealistic trust in the computer algorithms that allowed the subprime mortgage in the USA to go wild. Give mortgages to people who clearly couldn't possibly afford them. We are using a lot, and if you go to these business analytics conferences, I go to the company ones like IBM, like SAS, they keep selling models and predictive analytics. Depending on what you want to do, they can be fantastic. One of the problems, however, is that using all of these computer systems, it doesn't matter whether they're architect designing things or predictive analytics for retail, once we start using these tools, which in theory we could start off as advisory, very quickly we come to rely totally on them, and we have very, very blinkered perspectives. We only look at what the computer's doing, and not looking sideways at what the world is doing. We also de-skill our staff as well. As we rely more and more on technology, Gary Klein and Nicholas Carr, in his latest book, The Glass Cage, shows us we de-skill ourselves and our staff. If we build big data systems with rules and so on in it, and we saw this very clearly with subprime mortgage as well, people will game the system. The data becomes even more unreliable. In the subprime mortgage situation, the people selling these mortgages knew the rules and the criteria and filled the data in on the screens to reflect what would get an okay decision from the computer algorithm. And that happens time and time again. This film on the bottom is documented all watched over by Machines of Loving Grace. It's really well worth looking at. At the back end, there's some references. You'll see where the playlist is. By the way, folks, this is being videoed, and it will be up on my conference's YouTube channel in about a couple of days. Middle of next week, and I'll let John have that so that all of you can then get hold of it and find it. Again, in hindering insights, we have the problem of don't rocking the boat. People are too junior, they're too senior, too much experience, too little experience. All these sort of things clamp down on our ability to think outside of the box, to accept outside of the box ideas. Location. Location service on our lovely little mobile phones. Things that many of you are trying to use for push adverts based on the location of your opt-in client, customers and so on. So that you can send a retail message out saying, guys, you are next to our shop somewhere and there's a fabulous offer for you, 20% off on something. The classic one is Costco or Starbucks. Trouble is, your reputation is not going to be enhanced if that person receiving it is 3, 5, 10, 15, 40 miles from that outlet that you're advertising to them. And that's easy to do. Very easy to do indeed. Because although GPS is claimed to be that accuracy, if you have a GPS receiver sitting nicely in a perfect position and run it for 24 hours, collecting data for every second or two, yep. 95% of the readings will be accurate to within 10 metres. But our little gadgets aren't exactly in perfect visibility. The satellites are using all sorts of clever technology. And the result is, ThinkNear show over about a year and a half worth of monitoring astronomical numbers of adverts that are going out to reported locations. Look at that top one. That's the accuracy to within 100 metres. Only 40% of your adverts are probably going out to within 100 metres where you thought that customer was. The more interesting one, though, is that one. An error of 100 kilometres. I've got evidence on admittedly rather special circumstances, a bit challenging for a portable phone, 1800 miles error, and bigger. We've been doing quite a lot of work with students at Derby, but triggered by this, the little story that goes with this, that here I've got some examples where I was 22 kilometres away from where I thought I was. This is one where the phone took me for a journey while I was standing still. Not a very big journey, but it went for a journey of around about 300 metres. This one at night time, for a particular time at home, my phone, at middle of the night, would go for a walk 400 or 500 metres to the southwest. went to perfect visibility on top of Mont Royal in Montreal about a year ago. And the first photo I took, or the only photo I took on that occasion, was 5 kilometres in error. So I got my students to do some research. Interesting differences here about the error indoors, outdoors, which is not too unreasonable. But more interesting is this one, the huge difference between new technology and old technology using a couple of HTC phones. So indoors, which is one of the challenging ones, 10 meter accuracy roughly. The other model, 120 meters accuracy. Be careful. Different heights in the middle of a car park, down here, there, and up here, where the car park empty and the car park full. Very, very different situations. The green one was down at about that height between four cars. And the other one is the accuracy varies with time continuously. And I've got an example, I haven't shown it here because I've not processed it properly. But I had 25 minutes standing at the top of Montreal, and you can see every 5, 6, 7, 8 minutes the accuracy varied from accurate to quite bad. Now the governance consequences are quite interesting. One, you may not get your expected value from your project. Two, like we saw with Target and with several other organisations in the last year or so, there's quite nasty reputational risks. And they can be quite bad. You lose your customers potentially. And you guys all know that if you lose a customer, it's really expensive collecting new customers. The amount of marketing you've got to put in to capture new people, new customers, when you get in churn, is really, really difficult. So you don't want to upset your existing customer base. It's really rather expensive. And then the other thing is we do actually have a big problem in the UK or in Europe with personal data, because we're not really expected or required or allowed to keep inaccurate personal data. So here we are, busy potentially capturing lots of location data, maybe. We might have to, and I'll tell you why in a minute. So we need to mitigate the risks that we could pose to ourselves with big data analytics, with location services data, and so on. Now, those of you who know a bit about big data will have heard of the 4 or 6 V's of big data, from velocity, variety, and volume, and perhaps add value, which IBM added a little while later. My students came up with a total of 12, maybe 14 different V words that help you not to characterize big data, but to ask questions. Governance ultimately is not a list of do's and don'ts. If you are going to be successful with governance, you've used the governance frameworks as a way of asking sensible questions of yourself and about your project. Because only you know your organisation and its business well. Consultants don't. They know the processes, perhaps, and if you use your consultants to help you to ask the right questions about the business that you have the knowledge to answer, then you will get good answers. Those two URLs help you to understand a bit about the 12 V's. I haven't got time to tell you all about them. And use the insights from the Standish Group about questions. Questions, questions, questions. If I teach my students questions, they know how to learn for life. If I teach them answers, they stop learning and will not progress. So I am not here to give you answers, because that will stop you dead in your tracks. I'm here to give you sets of questions which will help you to become more successful into the future. Try to avoid that planning fallacy that Daniel Kahneman talked about in his book, Thinking Fast and Slow. Brilliant book to read. One of the problems we've begun to identify with location services, the first time you call location services on a smartphone, it's got problems. Highly random positioning errors. As I said, from something like 1,800 miles down to 5 miles, kilometres, sometimes perfectly accurate. It means you need to be taking multiple readings because it settles down, we think at the moment, we're doing some more research, but we think it settles down in about 30 seconds. We're not sure. Transport organisations using location services in their fleet management know they have to check the consistency of location, otherwise they're going to get unrealistic speed. Sometimes, in the middle of a journey, a lorry could be doing 70, 100, 200 miles an hour because of a location error. It's really bizarre. So you need also, as you start using things like big data analytics as using location services, you need to start thinking about what levels of error can you accept without causing a reputational damage or reputational risk. You've got to think about this. I'm not saying you can't use location services and location data, but you need to ask yourself consequences if the error, the location is wrong. 85% of roughly 25 meters accurate in what we've found so far. The problem is the other 15%, and particularly the last 2 or 3%, which can be very, very many. In terms of our data, think near, say it's much worse. Human insights, often they occur completely randomly, but how can we foster them? Gary Klein has some lots of interesting stuff about how we can help people to develop their insights. We need to think about our culture as well, corporate culture. How do we actively encourage it? How do we actively reinforce it by our actions of positive acceptance? Not just the insights and data, but all sorts of other things as well. So, the history tells us we shouldn't be trusting our computers too much, but we do need to trust our people. We need to rethink the level that we trust our technology as cognitive computing is coming in, as predictive analytics are coming in. There's a lot happening there, and we need to think about the rate of balance of our trust in our people, the balance of our trust in the computers. We need finally to think about the veracity of the data. Just how accurate is it? Can we prove which bits are accurate or not? How does that affect our insights we're gaining from that incredibly expensive technology, by and large? Three must-read books, folks. Gary Klein's book, Seeing What Others Don't, The Remarkable Way We Gain Insights, all about the insight process. The Glass Cage by Nicholas Cage, published last year, is an amazing tour de force that helps to think very much more clearly about what are the consequences of implementing vast amounts of very, very clever technology. And Daniel Kahneman's one, the Nobel Prize winner, Thinking, Fast and Slow. All sorts of interesting things in there. Those three books, I think, are mandatory reading for people in this field. And these are the sources. There'll be a PDF of this very shortly available for you. And then on Tuesday or Wednesday next week, the video of this will also be up there. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Have you got time for a question? Not really. I'll take them over coffee.
Richard, thank you very much indeed. And our next speaker is actually an ex-employee of mine, so I'm quite proud of this. Brenda Van Fleet is going to come on from the VF Corporation, the Global Marketing Director.